Thank you. Mercy come to those who know you and your truth, for the upright and Yeah. Oh. Thank you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we better meet. We are blessed today to have Father Maxim from the Basil Seminary, who is the spiritual leader here, a next door neighbor to be with us, and talk to us about the topic we actually, I think right now we all need. I want to just give you a message, relay a message from His Holiness, spoke to all of us, I spoke to Him yesterday, and He's asking for the prayers for everyone. He was having the all of the situation was happening. So it wasn't that happy, he wasn't in a good shape. But he's asking, what can he do? He said, for the people that need the prayers. So we need to pray for him, for the churches, and for Egypt. And today's topic, that's the topic we need because during this troubled time, the sadness we are living, those last couple of days, Father Maxman will talk to us about God's promise of joy. And we need joy in our life. And again, I thank Father Maxman for coming here and visiting us tonight.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Praise to Jesus Christ. I wish to thank Father Andrew for inviting me to be here this evening with you to pray on this feast of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Just yesterday, in our Byzantine Slavonic Rite, we celebrated the feast of the Dormition of the Mother of God. And Christians always spoke about falling asleep in the Lord. Just as we celebrate the Dormition of the Lord, each feast that we celebrate during our liturgical year has an important spiritual truth to convey to us. And what is this spiritual truth behind the Dormition, the falling asleep of the Mother of God have for us? It reminds us never to be afraid of death. Because in the Christian sense, death is not an end, but we see the grave. It is like the threshold to another stage. St. Basil talks about our earthly life as a school for the soul. It's a time of learning. It's a time of preparation for that which is yet to unfold, that which is yet to come. And so we realize that this life brings us to another state of existence. Many times our Lord told a parable. What is our life on earth like? It's like a master who goes away and he leaves his servants in charge. And he does something very strange. When the master leaves, he doesn't appoint a substitute to take his place. He does something unexpected. He gives his wealth to his servants, and he says, go out and make use of it. And so, what is he? When he does this, he's saying, I want you to be like me. I want you to take responsibility on yourselves to administer these goods. The one who was given 5 talents, make 5 more. The one who was given 2 talents, make 2 more. But the foolish servant went and buried his master's talent in the ground and gave it back to him. He achieved nothing in his life on earth. And sometimes that's sad. Sometimes we're afraid to do anything. We see that fear paralyzes, but faith enlivens. And so what is important is always to have faith as we go through this life. And of course, the Blessed Virgin Mary, she was not only the Mother of God, but a wonderful example of discipleship. What enabled her, when the angel Gabriel came at the time of the Annunciation, to say, I am the handmaid of the Lord, let it be done unto me according to your will. She was able to say that because she had faith in God. And we read the story of Mary's birth. It's very interesting. This is recorded in the proto evangelium of St. James. And we hear about Joachim and Anna, the parents of the Blessed Virgin Mary, and they were getting older in life, and Joachim goes to the temple to offer his gifts to God, and the high priest will not accept them. He says, you cannot be righteous in the eyes of God because you don't have any choice. And so, how does Joachim solve this problem? What does he do? He doesn't lose faith. But he goes out to the desert place, and he goes to read what we would call the sacred scripture, the record of the tribes of Israel, to find if there was a righteous person who lived on earth and did not have any children. Meanwhile, his wife Anna's in the garden, and she's looking around, and she sees the fruitfulness in nature, the fruit trees bearing fruit, the animals, the livestock they had, bearing young. And she is childless, and she laments, you know, not having any children. And at that time, the angel of the Lord appeared to her and told her that she would have a child. And so we see it was only at the end of their lives that the prayers of Joachim and Anna were fulfilled in the birth of a child. And not just any child. We call Mary at the time of the Annunciation. This is the beginning of our salvation because she was able to say yes to God. She was open to God. And so here we see this God's promise of joy. It's not a joy that we see when we celebrate a new year, but it's a much deeper joy. It's like the apostles and disciples returned to Jesus and they were amazed that the evil spirits were subservient to them. But Jesus says, do not rejoice because of the power you have over the spirits, but rejoice because your names are written in heaven. And this is our true joy. To be the sons and daughters of God. This is the God's promise of joy. That he is a father who loves us. And so, when Jesus was describing our life on earth, he told this parable of the prodigal son. It was interesting, once 2 months, they were discussing this parable of the prodigal son, and the older one told the younger one, if the mother of those 2 sons, the wife of that man is alive, the younger son never would have left home. And it tells us something important about family life, how we need one another to grow and develop. But what happens to this young son? He has to listen to his father, his older brother, and he gets tired of it. He wants to go out and seek his own fortune. And so he asks his father, give me my inheritance. And this is something strange. For a son to come to his father, it's like saying, I wish you were dead. Give me what would come to me after your death. It's a horrible thing to demand an inheritance when the father is still alive. And yet the father realizes the only way that his younger son is going to learn what's important in life is to let him learn by his own experience. No matter what he would have said or did, probably would have not changed his young son's mind. And so, the father gives him his inheritance, and the young man goes out into the world to seek his fortune. Just imagine, a young person with a great deal of wealth, complete freedom, he goes to the far country to find his fortune. And what does he do? He spends all his money on riotous living. He just enjoys the pleasures of the flesh and nothing more. But imagine the possibilities this young man had. They could have taken the money from his inheritance and bought a piece of land and become a farmer like his father. They could have taken the money, gone study, become a doctor, a lawyer, a teacher, had some profession, but he didn't do that. He could have taken the money and started a business to be a merchant. If he didn't want to work, he could have put the money in the bank and lived off the interest. But no, he had to play the big shot. And he just spent all his money just on seeking his own pleasure. And the turning point in the parable comes when the young man is close to death. His money ran out, there's a great famine in the land, and he finally realizes if he wants to stay alive, he's going to have to do something. So he comes up with a plan. He says, what I'm going to do, I'll get a job. And so he hires himself to one of the landowners in the far country. And what does he do? The landowner gives him the swine to take care of. Imagine what it meant for a Jew to be placed in charge of the swine. The landowner was more interested in the herd of swine than he was in the young man. And then he realized, what was it like for the workers on his father's farm, how well they were treated? They're going to give him anything to eat. And so he realized, without the bread of my father's house, I will surely die. And so what does he do? He repents. He realizes he has sinned against God. He has wasted his life. He's done nothing productive. And so he repents. He goes home and he decides, I will go home and work on my father's estate as one of the hired hands. Because he realizes sin has consequences. He has sinned against God. Because he didn't do anything with his life. He just wasted his time, his money, his resources, just on his own enjoyment. He sinned against his father because he didn't respect his father. He didn't do anything to help his family. And so he decides to repent and go home. And when he's going home, a strange thing happens. His father runs out to greet him. See, usually, especially among the Jewish people, the children knelt down before their father. But the father runs out, embraces his son. And this is a beautiful image, not only of repentance, but also forgiveness. It manifests the greatness of God's love for each and every one of us. No matter what sins we may have committed, if we are truly repentant, God will forgive us. He accepts us back. And so when the young man comes home, what does the father do? He tells the servants, bring out the finest garment. He is welcomed back home as an honored guest. He says, put a ring on his finger. At that time, many times the rings were a signet ring. And instead of writing your name on a document, the person would make a seal with the family crest that this was authorized. That he was a person of responsibility. And the father says, bring him sandals. And the sandals symbolize that he will be sent out into the world with jobs to do, given to him by his father. And we see in this parable that love can only come from within. Each and every one of us has to decide for oneself what is important in life. And in this parable, we see a revelation of the greatness of God's love for each and every one of us. That just as he welcomes back the prodigal son, he welcomes us back as well. And the parable has no ending. It's kind of strange that it ends with the father discussing with the older son, come, celebrate. Your younger brother was dead and he has come back to life. He is lost and now he is found. And the older brother doesn't want to go in. He says, what did you ever do for me? Did you ever give me a kid go to celebrate with my friends? And so we are left without any conclusion. Jesus wants us to ask ourselves, are we like the merciful father who forgives his son, or we like the older brother who is unwilling to forgive? And so this reminds us, how can we treat other people when they have offended us? Are we like the father who is forgiving and loving, accepts him back as one of the family, but we like the older brother who stands back and doesn't want to celebrate, doesn't want to start a new life, because they let him be punished. And so, if they only ask for punishment, there can be no new beginning. It is only with forgiveness that we can go on in life, forget the past, and have a new beginning. And this gives us joy. So what do we learn about the importance of God's promise of joy? We have to realize that we should always look for the good in the people around us. There's an old Persian parable that recounts Jesus walking down the roadside with his apostles and disciples. And along the roadside, they come across the corpse of a dead dog in advanced stages of decay. It's putrid. It's disgusting. It stinks. All the apostles and disciples are on the other side of the road. Jesus looks down and he says, "What beautiful teeth he has." In spite of everything that's disgusting, repulsive, Jesus finds something beautiful. And this is important for us to learn to always look for the good in each person, in each event that we come across in life. That we have to have this positive attitude in life. And one beautiful example of having a positive attitude comes from Benjamin Franklin. You probably heard a lot of Franklin, how he was the inventor of the lightning rod. He proved that lightning was really electricity. He invented the Franklin stove, where most of the heat remained in the building instead of going out the chimney. He invented bifocals. He was a great statesman and diplomat. He brought the French to aid the Americans in the War of the Revolution. He was in Philadelphia. He organized a fire department, a lending library. And how is it possible that Franklin achieved so much in his life? And he said when he was a young man, there's one phrase that occupied his thinking for a long time. And it goes like this. Many people complain to God that he has created thorns and roses. And Franklin said, why not thank God for having created the roses with the thorns? So each person we meet, each event we encounter, we see the beauty and also the negative part. We see the roses and the thorns. And if we turn our attention to the thorns, to the negative, nothing good can ever come out of it. There's an old joke about this Englishman, a Frenchman, and a Russian. And they're walking along the beach, and they find a magic lantern. They rub it, the genie comes out. Each of one of you gets a wish. So the Englishman says, I want £1 million. Good, he gets his £1 million. The Frenchman said, I want a grand estate. So he gives him a big mansion. And the Russian says, well, I don't have a goat. My neighbor has a goat. I wish his goat died. And so, if we just look for the negative, I mean, some of us, it's easy to be preoccupied. Instead of wishing for something positive, something good, we can be imprisoned by our own negative thinking. And this is what we want to get away from. It's only when we look for the good in other people, in each event, that we're able to find this God's promise of joy in our lives. And so we see that in this feast of the Blessed Virgin Mary that we celebrate, the dormition, the falling asleep, we see the importance of what really happens at the time of death. That this is not a passing away, but it's a transformation. We see the grave is truly the threshold to the rest of eternity. It's a new beginning. And in our Byzantine Slavonic tradition, a lot of times they would place the icon of the dormition of the Blessed Virgin Mary on the doors above the church. And that was the last icon the faithful would see as they were leaving church. And why did they do that? We are reminded every time we look at the icon of the dormition of the Mother of God, we are reminded not to be afraid of death. If we are like the Blessed Virgin Mary, if we go through our life with faith and hope, if we look for the good, then when the time of our death comes, a lot of times we see in this icon, Jesus is spiritually present. And he is holding in his arms what appears to be a small ball, which symbolizes the soul of the Blessed Virgin Mary. And he's taking Mary's soul up to the hands of his heavenly Father. That just as Mary, when she passes from this life into eternity, Jesus comes to take her to his heavenly Father. And so if we live like Mary lived, with faith, hope, and love, we can expect our Lord at the time of our death to come and bring us into the arms of his heavenly Father. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.